whatsoever in your ranked games anymore. But moving forward, we also have ult mechanics kind of being cleaned up for this, and this is the one that hits a few champions, but Androxus is the special case, so I'll let you explain him and then splash on down to the rest.
Yeah, so first part of Androxus's change is going to be that he will now refund 15% of his ultimate charge for each ult charge not consumed. And so what this is doing, right, we're looking at standardizing how our champions consume their ultimate charge, because yeah. Paladins, you know, through 4+ years has had a variety of teams. The team that is on it right now for the past 2 years, we really want to kind of fix up some of these inconsistencies, as you could, you know, tell with the text pass as well. And so, like, ultimates where I would start it and then die before I even got an effect, and I would have my ult consumed, felt really bad. So the second part of this is what we're doing on a few champions is you will not consume your ultimate charge on the following champions until the pre-fire has actually been completed. So Androxus is the primary one. And then his 15% refund is very similar to how Victor expends his ammo or his ultimate charge. Up next is going to be Fernando, who is also unique in his own regard. Players can now cancel this ability early. Congratulations. It, you know, for the minor instances that you may want to cancel it early, you could do that now. Important to note that we plan on doing Torvald as well. After investigating how he's configured, basically tech-wise, it was going to be a little bit too much investment for what our goals were for getting out this patch. We're going to be looking at giving Torvald that functionality moving forward. And then Grok Tempest will no longer consume ultimate charge until pre-fire is completed. We have given the same pass to Ruckus as well, his Hexafire. Also, no longer consuming that ultimate charge until the pre-fire has been completed, until players have gained an effect from their ultimate, a benefit, whether it's hurting enemies or healing allies. And then Vivian as well has this. So Sentinels will no longer take ultimate charge until the pre-fire has been completed. So.
And for Vivian, that feels like a double down, because she already charges her ult while she has those Sentinels out. So you're going to be deadly, deadly Sentinels coming through. But those are the ones that are kind of in the group. Now we can jump into other champions. And actually, Cassie, this is kind of also in a group, but it's going to be splashed around a few different champions. So you're going to, I think, explain the tech behind it. And then when you hear this phrase in the future, you'll know that this is what it means. So dodge roll for Cassie is being changed to increase momentum carry after dodge roll ends. So you can go ahead and explain what that means and how that impacts the game.
So for those of you who missed our last patch notes or weren't aware of this, is that we did roundabout changes to how our charges are implemented. Tech-wise, right? And that led to fantastic improvements, specifically around server correction, and more specifically around players that had high ping and having to deal with server correction. But what this meant was that kind of how our momentum carry system post-charge worked kind of got changed a little bit and altered. For the most part, we didn't view this as a problem, but there were a few champions that we wanted to make improvements on after the first patch. And so these aren't, you know, these characters, for the most part, all already had a little bit of momentum charge, and this will just allow them to push a little bit further. Most importantly, it's really when they're in the air that players felt this the most, right? Where they would just, like, characters that would drop like a rock. Maeve was a big one. I believe we actually hotfixed her in the other day, so Maeve should be working fine in live. But dodge roll Cassie will be one of the things getting this benefit. And there'll be multiple of those throughout this.
Jeez, yeah.
I will not re-explain this.
So you're going to get that explanation. Whenever you see that sentence that you see down there on the screen, that's what that means. And now we can move into, I think, a more interesting change. Because Dredge, this is a fun one. I like the way this is going to end up, so I'm just going to let you go through. It's a cursed howitzer and a little bit of Kraken changes.
We have a lot of balance changes here, but I'm probably going to spend the most time on Dredge. So Dredge, historically, his ult has basically been like, I guess I'll use it, right? It's really powerful, but it required so much setup to actually be effective that it almost felt like a non-ability against players that were at some competency to be able to, like, I'm in this big red circle, I should probably get out. And I know there are players out there who don't do this, but a lot of players are very easily able to get out of that, even without movement abilities. Also, there was a little bit of a pre-fire delay on, like, so you would fire the ability and it wouldn't actually deploy at your crosshair. There would be about a 0.2, there would be a 200 millisecond frame or frames worth that where your crosshair ended up would actually deploy it. So you could start the ability and whip your camera 180 if you're fast enough and actually deploy it behind you. Which can kind of hurt a lot, right? Because in Dredge's case, right, A lot of times he's like, when I fire this, I want it to just fire where I'm pointing. So, lower thirds aren't matching up because I'm going out of order. I apologize, production. They're probably all hating me right now.
That's fine.
As they change it. Yes, yeah, sorry. Sorry, guys. So we've removed the pre-fire timing ability, right? So like where you fired at your crosshair is where it's going to deploy at. And then we have also reduced time to deploy from 2 seconds to 1.7. So Kraken, once you press the ability, is going to be coming out half a second faster, which is very significant when you're looking at players' ability to get in and out of it. Also, if you're able to slow them with Harpoon, right, it's a more guaranteed follow-up. But what this means is we are going to be reducing the damage because you are going to be hitting this more frequently. Even in testing, more players are getting hit by this. So damage is not going to be a one-hit, one-kill anymore for most characters. It's going from 4,000 to 1,400. But we'll just take a look at significantly faster. We've also increased the knockback as you can. Most people don't even know it had a knockback because either people died or it was a front line, and so maybe they get moved around a little bit. But we've now increased the efficiency, right? This is going to be way... The players are going to need to have so much more cognizance of when this comes out, right? Like, you have to react to it immediately. There's no extra little bit of timing for you to actually take a second to look at where's the best way to get out. You kind of just have to move. And if you're already engaging someone, like, there's a strong chance you're going to get hit by this ultimate now.
Mm. All the Inaras out there cursing themselves for being so slow already. That it's like, well, I guess I'm just going to have to take this one on the chin.
Yeah, so we felt like this is actually giving Dredge an ultimate, right? That wasn't dependent on I need my Saris to set me up.
Yeah.
Because that's really where Dredge's ultimate was that it required setup from the rest of your team. And even if you have competent players on your team, right, like, unless you're in a voice comms communicating exact timings, it doesn't feel consistent. And so we believe this will make Dredge feel like he has an actual ultimate now instead of just a ton of power in his base kit. And then, sorry to bring it back, production, we are taking some power out of his weapon reload, and this is a double hit, right? Scuttle is probably one of the most frustrating talents. You know, we see that a lot. And so this is going to hurt Scuttle's ability to burst players, right? You'll still potentially get like the 1850 against flanks and you can combo them, but against some higher health players, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
So we just wanted to take a little bit of power out of that reload projectile, put it into a more consistent ultimate that's also going to just feel better and make more of an impact.
Yeah, so it's going down 1,000 damage, 850, but I'm excited for the new Kraken. I think it's going to be a lot more fun to try and get that one out. And then we have some other changes that are coming forward. After Dredge comes Drogo's. And this one's kind of interesting because you're pulling a little bit out of the talent and putting it into the base kit. A lot kind of like what we had done with some cards and Barrick a couple of updates ago. Mm-hmm. But this one, I think, impacting the booster a lot more, making him feel more jetpacky.
So we're, we kind of have done a lot of these power shifts. I'm personally a really big fan of them, where it's not necessarily buffing or nerfing, but making a character a little bit more consistent in what they do and maybe hurting their damage to compensate or their defensibility. Something has to give, right, when you're shifting power. Worm Jets right now, ever since we released it, right, like, flying with Worm Jets feels really, 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 really good. Flying with base booster feels really, really, really bad, where you're not really flying. You're kind of like, I guess I'll have a super jump for a second. So we've basically increased the base booster effectiveness. This is a pretty vague number. There's multiple knobs and variables to this, but it's about 25% more effective.
So you'll be able to fly a little bit better.
A little bit better.
Just normal Drogo's.
Much more consistent at, like, you're not going to stay in the air forever, but you could stay in there for a little bit longer, especially if you have some of the more fuel or booster affecting cards. And then Worm Jets is getting two things. One, it is obviously losing 25%. So this will still have the same acceleration, a very, very, very slight lower max speed. But overall, won't feel like you're losing too much, but it will no longer increase booster regeneration rate. So for those who don't know, your booster regenerated faster. So this means with this shift, right, with the booster now no longer increasing your regeneration rate, like, players have to be way more cognizant, because that was the problem with me for Worm Jets, is that, like, you didn't have to think about managing your fuel. You were just in the air, and you're like, oh, I got to hit my thrust real quick and then not consume booster for X seconds, and then I'm back. And you weren't really having to worry about this resource management system that you should have to stay in the air like that. And so this will allow Drogo's to still have good flight, good movement in Worm Jets, but they either A, have to put more loadout points into increasing your base fuel or getting fuel regeneration or decreasing fuel consumption after thrust or getting kills to get fuel. So you'll have to be way more cognizant of like where you're at in your booster. Otherwise, you're going to plummet to the ground.
Customize it a little more for staying in the air as opposed to just staying in the air and getting everything else. Yes. So he's going to be able to, well, still fly just the same, but you're going to have to tweak it a little bit. Next on the list, it's going to be Fernando. So not only is he getting the ability to cancel out of Immortal early, but he's having a couple of things. I actually really like these changes because they're feel-good changes for him, and a lot of them are around the shield and its cooldown, and as such, also his max time that he's going to be able to kind of keep it up.
And I wasn't going to explain everything, but I just want to explain everything. but I don't want to be here forever. So quick look, right? Fernando will go through the numbers, and then we'll talk about kind of the theory around it. So first off, his shield, his cooldown's getting reduced from 15 seconds to 12 seconds. Mm-hmm. We are reducing the max active time from 10 seconds to 8 seconds. His charge, as we mentioned before, getting increased momentum carry after charge ends, feels slightly better. And then he's getting a new card. So this previously Towering Barrier, what it did was it increased the max health of your shield, which is doesn't really do much against Wrecker. So it said this cooldown will now reduce the cooldown of your shield up to 4 seconds if you max it out. Obviously, you need to invest cards into it, which takes out some of Fernando's other good defensive or power cards with Fireball cooldown reduction. But overall, I think this will make Fernando a much more well-rounded champion. Also, the Aegis is getting 2 seconds off cooldown instead of the down to 12-second cooldown.
All right, so you're going to be able to get your shield up a little bit more, and if you bring it down with this card, you're going to have the uptime up. I know anybody who plays against Khan, since the cooldown or shield goes on cooldown whenever you get grabbed, you're probably going to like this card a ton. So it's going to be comfortable for Fernando mains, and you get to cancel out of your old early.
Yeah, and big theory here is that Fernando, again, you've kind of mentioned it, right? He's the only frontline that has to kind of carry his defensive shield, right? So there's two things. One, he can get stunned out of it or locked out of it. Two, he's locked out of doing really much else. He can charge with it, but you're really not doing anything else with it. And so this just means like his uptime should be more.
Yeah.
Right? He should have more uptime if he's not able to detach from his shield. Where other frontlines are like, I'll just throw this and then I can also still participate in the battle. And if I get stunned, it doesn't matter. My shield is still doing its job. So we think this will position him more as like frequent uptime when it comes to shield versus the strength of the shield itself.
Yeah. It's going to feel good. I'm excited for it again as someone who almost always ends up being a frontline player. It's always nice to see those changes come through. We're going to skip a couple letters though, go down. The next one on the list is Imani.
Yes.
And this one, again, it's a few changes around the place, but some of it's shifting from cards into base kit and then letting the cards be more impactful in what they do instead of having that be the force change to make her be effective only with that loadout.
Yes. I also, just quick throwback, because this is an AOC request. Fernando was a light AOC request or just a general request to change it.
Yeah.
And then Drogo's, the Worm Jets power shift was an AOC request. So shout outs to the AOC and for all of them that participated in the summit. I'll try and remember because they're not marked on here. So Imani, Pyreball. So we've added an in-hand offset for charged Pyreballs. Before they were actually following your ice shard stance, where like, even though visually it's always coming from your right, if you happen to have the offset on the left, you would shoot it from the right visually, but it would get caught because it's actually coming out here. So you'd catch on walls a lot where you're like, oh, I'll peek from the right side of this wall, but I'm actually firing to the left, then it clips. So no longer will be the case. It has its own unique offset for charged versions only. Tapping it will still do the left, right, left, right. Then Inferno Cannon. So players will now be able to move during base at this ability. So the Swift Sphere card previously gave this effect.
Yeah.
But now it is equivalent to what Swift Sphere 3 was previously, for those of you that played with that card. And then Swift Seer is actually, we're not changing the text of it, but it has, we've kind of in the background adjusted exactly what it's increasing. And it is increasing Swift Seer at 100%. What this means is that it'll be about 20% more effective than the previous maxing of Swift Seer was when you max it now, though, with a base movement speed. So it's a lot of numbers in the background that aren't well displayed on patch notes, but overall, you can now move at base with Inferno Cannon, and if you max Swift Seer, you move a little bit faster than you did before.
Very similar to the Frostbomb change, where it was just the base movement of it got a little bit nerf, like it was slower, but with the card, it could go a little faster.
Yes.
Same concept here. You can move in it, And if you decide to max out your card, you can move faster in either way. And right after her, we have Io coming through. So we had a couple of fixes with her earlier. Now an ability. This one affects Moonlight and more of the line of sight around it and how it was kind of breaking a little faster. Now it's going to be a little easier to maybe keep that on your target.
Yeah, so you can read it right there. Basically, we're not going to break Io's link. During immediate loss of sight, there'll be about a, I think it's a 0.8 second window right now. Really, this is to combat the people stepping in and out, right? Like, if someone's going behind a wall for a long time, like, we want the link to break. She's meant to be strong, but she has to have line of sight. And you can see now, I think it's actually a second. So you can lose line of sight. It'll keep the heal up for that duration. You still are going to have to aim it at the player as you would normally. But this should help with, especially some maps like Bazaar, where you have a bunch of pillars that people are dying, or just corners that people are like going in and out of. So we think this is a nice quality of life, slight buff when it comes to actual numbers and effectiveness.
Also lets you stay safe. Much like that, you can kind of keep peeking, and it'll kind of reset the timer as the line of sight breaks. So you can keep the heal going and keep yourself alive while doing so. So
don't abuse
ideally keeping the maximum amount of healing for your team up. So take note of what you just saw there, because I expect to see a lot of IOs doing it. The next on the list, though, is going to be Khan. Is, you know, the same thing that we saw earlier. I'll just go through this. Commander's Grab, increased momentum carry after Commander's Grab in. So that's just going to feel better, especially for players with higher ping, as you had mentioned earlier, but just in general. And then Koga is next one on the list, getting a general kind of increase base movement.
Very
and
slight.
Then some changes elsewhere.
Get him help a little bit in movement speed. Also abilities for Shadow Step also will receive the increased momentum carry. Very, very, very minor adjustment to him, but should help players sail a very short distance if they use this in air, but not across the map. And then Cyclone Strike, there was actually a small window where Koga, even though visually he's still dashing around after his ultimate had ended, that he was hittable, and we didn't intend that, or we don't like that. So he will now be immune until he's actually back to the main spot, right? If he's still dashing, he won't take damage at the end of the ult.
And so you'll regain control and then maybe die, depending on where you are.
Probably right after
or live, either way. But
not before you.
You'll at least be immune during the duration that you're meant to be. And that's fine.
Don't tell
anyone. We'll clean it up.
All the people watching.
So the next one on the list, and actually the next two on the list, are going to be very similar changes. You've heard this phrase before. Maeve, increased momentum carry after pounce ends. This was one that was actually in the previous hotfix, as you had mentioned, because you said she was the one you could feel it the most on, when you'd kind of hit the end and then just
kind of broke her combo, drop what she was doing.
Now she'll feel more comfortable. And then Maldamba with Slither. After Slither ends, he'll have a little bit more increased momentum after that. So that's just going to keep those champions feeling nice. Movement abilities as a whole, these last couple of updates have been completely smoothed over. And there's still, I think, maybe a couple on the list for later, but this is hitting so many. We still have more changes, by the way.
We got to power through this now. We got to show off the reason we're all in pirate shenanigans.
Oh, I thought that was just because of the dredge changes.
Oh, that's true. Could be.
See, there's a blanket
definitely
cover.
We definitely
so
don't have
too
pirate
long.
Skins.
Either way, so Pip is the next one on the list. A little bit of talent change and a little bit of card change.
Yeah, AOC request, combat medic. So weapon shots are now going to be healing for 750. Previously was 600, so this should make this a talent that can directly compete with your healing potion. So excited about that. And then Pep in the Step, getting a little bit of shift in power, going from 3 second increased duration on the movement speed, but significantly less movement speed. So more uptime, less burst effectiveness on MS gain.
Yeah. And then Ruckus on the list, increased momentum after his carry in, or increase momentum carry after advance ends. You dash, it feels better. If you haven't gotten that yet, I'm just going to keep saying it. Strix, next on the list. This is actually a very interesting thing, because I think this is one of the first cards, maybe in my mind, that has this kind of effect on it.
Yeah. So Roost was like an at-will DR move, but it, you know, kind of allowed him to duel players too effectively, especially other snipers, right? If you're in a Kinesa versus Strix battle, it's like, well, it doesn't matter if I get the first shot off. I'm not killing him if I'm Kinesa. Mostly because he was able to get this DR on cooldown. Not even on cooldown, just like at will. Personal DR is really strong, and we didn't really like how that was done. Right, Io has something similar, but that's delivered to you through another player versus just like, all right, I am hitting right trigger or right mouse button, and now I have, you know, 30x% DR. We felt that was a little bit too strong for what we wanted, and it was obviously we have no visual tell to back it up. So now players will gain ultimate charge on hits with Talon Rifle, so up to 10%. So going to increase your ultimate charge rate, get your flashbang, use it a little bit, you know, have your defensive ability up a little bit more. And then Dexterous, we're also reducing the effectiveness. This is the weapon swap, is going from 20% scaling down to 10% scaling, so you can switch it 50% as fast and not basically insta-swap into your flare projectile combo.
So you're going to be more sniper-oriented, less
shot-switch-shot. You could still do this shot-switch-shot, but there's a little bit slower, right? So it's going to take more prediction, right, from you as the Strix as well. Mm-hmm. There's a larger burden of knowledge for that. Yeah. Stop looking at it.
And so, yeah, this one is going to be... The coffee doesn't exist, as far as we're concerned. This one, so I'm going to glance over this because you want to dive into the explanation more with the next change, but yes. Torvald... Field study, damage or reduce the damage increase that you get from his bubble from 30% down to 15%, and you're going to dive into that because it's kind of tied in with the next change that is Tyra, whose Hunter's Mark is going to be feeling the same kind of change.
Yeah, Tyra's getting a little bit more of a shift, so we can just go down Tyra at first, and then I'll kind of do theory again. I like that style a little bit more. So first up, Hunter's Mark. We are reducing the cooldown of Hunter's Mark. Don't fret yet. From 15 seconds to 14 seconds. It's a buff, I know. End of the world. We are reducing the duration from 6 seconds to 5 seconds. Additionally, for Hunting Party itself, the talent, not the ability, no longer increases damage amp, so you are still gaining the 15%, you and your allies, but you're not getting the bonus to 25 that it was at. We've also removed the cooldown reduction on it, so see, it all works in the end. And then Favored Quarry, we are changing how that card actually functions. So previously, Favored Quarry was the 2% or 2 second scaling up to 10 second increase in your reveal, which meant players were essentially, if that's maxed out, revealing people for like 15 seconds, right?
Yeah.
And so at a high level for Tyra, we felt like the uptime that this ability offered with the correct cards versus the investment from Tyra was too great, right? You just can like throw it on, not even think about it, not even have to worry about reapplying it. So we think like kind of shifting this now to increase the duration of Hunter's Mark at a much lower value. So technically you can get more damage amp for longer, but only up to 3 seconds if you invest all of this, and you're not gonna be revealing people for 10 extra seconds.
Yeah.
They'll be revealed for up to 3 extra seconds. So really we're just kind of condensing the window, right? We want Tyra to have more uptime. Have to manage the uptime of these more and be more cognizant, right? She can't just throw it on someone and be like, well, I guess you're revealed for the next half hour. 15
good luck
seconds,
never
half
being
hour.
Seen.
Feels the same in a fast-paced shooter. So happy with shifting Tyra here. And then at a larger kind of look, right, with the damage amp adjustment is like, we like damage amp. Damage amp, is healthy in the right ways, right?
Yeah.
So like with Tyra specifically, it's like, I have damage amp, but it's like doing all these other things and also revealing the person for a very, 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 very long time.
Yeah.
At a very high value. And so basically it's like for these next 8 seconds or whatever it was before, you are not doing anything against me. With Torvald, it was a smaller window, right? It's the opposite problem, where it's not a long window of a constant effect. It's like a super, super powerful swing, because not only are you getting the 30% damage amp, you're also getting the 3K shield. And so what that that creates is like a very minute window of opportunity for a player to just say, you aren't beating me for these 2 seconds.
Yeah.
No matter who you are, essentially, like, I am the better character, mm-hmm. and there's nothing you can do that's skill-based to combat that.
Yeah.
And that requires, obviously, extra coordination, right? So Torvald just inherently scales with player skill and more so player coordination.
Also, now uniform, nice 15% on all your damage amp. That's going to be coming down. So Tyra, Torvald, and Genos all going to be only giving 15% bonus, so kind of keeping those numbers in line. I think that's going to be very comfortable. The next change up on the list, Ying, Life Exchange, removed inaccuracy on Shatter. That one is kind of self-explanatory for what it is. And then Zen, Whirl. Well, as you can imagine, increased momentum carry after Whirl ends. And that's going to do it for all of the balance that's going to be through. Yeah, yep, that's it. No, actually, we have...
Don't leave. Wait, we have stuff.
Way more to go through. So the next one is actually still going to... It's not even the pirate reason anymore. We're going to, I think, more polish. This is actually another feel-good change, though. Mm-hmm. And it is a UI rework that's going to be coming through. And so I think, you know, Rafe, you can actually talk about this maybe a little more as to what's being changed and why we're changing.
Yeah, so basically with the UI rework, we didn't touch a whole lot of the